Welcome back to Skyrim for Seniors. And I do mean citizens, not high schoolers. Not collegians, but senior citizens, folks old enough to draw their Social Security. Well, I said last time that I was doing this for fun, and I said I was doing it because I really, really, really would like to get older folks my age. I'm 68. I'll be 69 in a couple of months. It's now August, late August of 2015. And I would sincerely like to get people my age involved in this type of gaming. Now, I have no, I mean, there's plenty of different types of gaming. And while I don't care for some of the other types, that's irrelevant. What I like is not relevant. I mean, it's relevant to me, of course, personally, but it has no relevance overall. You know, I mean, what a person likes is totally up to them. And the important thing is to be doing something and playing something, because what it does is it keeps your mind active and interested. And apparently, that is a big deal, a very, very big deal. The older you get, the more important it is for your mind to stay active. And this video gaming is, oh, for heaven's sakes. Is a, whoa, there goes a deer way up in the air. I hope you saw that. That was very cool. Where are you? There you are. Thief. Just a simple, straightforward thief. Glass armor, scale boots with a mage hood. What kind of outfit is that? Good heavens, you're not even dressed very well. Run away, deer, or whatever you are. Run away, run away. It's as simple as that. Us old folks need to stay engaged and involved. And with the advent of the gaming consoles, you don't need any computer skills whatsoever. So, it's simple. Now, I am playing on a computer, just for your interest's sake. I'm playing on a computer with a, what's this thing called in my hand? It's called a controller. That's what it's called. I tried it with a keyboard and mouse, and it just doesn't work for me. For me, again, everything is me. I don't care what you do. I don't care what anybody does. I think everybody should do exactly what they want to do. And I find the controller to be much easier to use for gaming than a keyboard and a mouse. I also play without any mods. Although, let me make it clear that I think modding is good for gaming. And I applaud those game companies which work with modding and make modding available for their games. I think Bethesda is very smart. I think that modding helps to prolong the effective life of a game and is very, very good for the industry. And Bethesda is very smart to be so involved with the modding community. I don't use mods. I did in the past. I'm a very long time Civ player. When Sherry was dying, I used Civ to occupy my time. Now, if this was back, this was Civ 2, I think. That's how long ago. Whatever, those of you that know anything about Civ, that might give you an idea of the dates that I'm talking about, which was the early 2000s. Because she was diagnosed with ALS in January of 2000, and she died in August 8th of 2004, and so I'm pretty sure it was Civ. That's when I started with Civ, was with two. Civ 2. I never played the original Civ. Civ 2 was my first, and then I went all the way up to 5, at which point I rage quit playing Civ because of Steam. As far as I'm concerned, Steam absolutely ruined the Civilization franchise. And actually, I would have switched to PC on Skyrim faster if I hadn't have had to deal with Steam. Oh, those are Khajiit caravanners. They're running to get to the next location so they can set up their caravan stuff. But I finally had to bite the bullet, mainly because when you play a game as long as I do, 500 to 1,000 hours, you eventually get to the point where a quest hangs up, refuses to run, something goes wrong with it.
Gods, another fight.
And on a console, when that happens, you're just out of luck. You're just completely out of luck. There's nothing you can do if I mean, there are some fixes you can make. Now that's just amazing. Is that an amazing balancing act or what? Now let's see what happens if I walk into it. Nope, that's what I thought. See, sometimes that's what happens. You just simply can walk straight through it as though it wasn't even there. Sometimes that'll knock it over, and sometimes it's just as though it didn't exist. It just sort of depends. It's all got to do with that particular type of programming that this thing works with. Oh crap, I keep forgetting. Object-oriented, that's what it's called. Object-oriented programming. It makes what they do possible. It makes the games that we have nowadays possible, but it also causes the problems that exist in the games. It's the reason for this sort of thing, the object-oriented programming. I got out of programming before, well, actually, when it was starting is when I started getting out of programming. At any rate, that's not what I'm supposed to be talking about. What I was talking about, rats. Oh, come on. Oh no. Oh, doggone it. Oh, that is so cool. That is so very cool. I got sidetracked. I don't think I was sidetracked. I think I was on target. Civ. I was talking about Civ and the fact that I modding, yes, the fact that I used a lot of mods back with Civ. Oh, those are going to be, well, I know who they are. And I loved mods. I just loved them. And up through Civ 4, I used a tremendous amount of mods. And eventually, I stopped using them altogether. Anybody that's used a lot of mods will understand. I don't use mods. I don't even have the unofficial Skyrim patch installed, which is apparently de rigueur if you're using a PC. I don't use it. Anybody wants to use it, please use it. I'm not, don't care. I've looked at it. I don't see that it is that helpful. It doesn't. There's no problems that are that bad that it fixes that bother me that much. So I don't bother with it. It fixes a bunch of little things that really don't bother me. So I don't mess with it. And as far as a lot of the modded things, a great deal of the things that modders do change the game unnecessarily, in my opinion. For example, they change the color scheme of the game. Well, really, why are you here alone? Why are you an Imperial all by yourself?
Stay sharp.
Oh, you're not by yourself. There's your two buddies. Yeah, they're usually in sets of three. Yeah, hurry up and catch up, fellas. Skyrim is a cold land. It's a cold land. It's supposed to be a bit gray and washed out. It's exactly the way it's supposed to look. But one of the main things that modders do is brighten up the colors. Seems to be the very first thing that modders set out to do. When in fact, it was obviously a very carefully thought out choice on the part of the designers. To have the muted color scheme. And I see no reason to change the muted color scheme. This thing, whatever this is called, I don't know the generic name for all of this business. That business seems to bother the modders to no end. And in the YouTubes, they just complain vociferously about it, and there's a mod that changes the look of that, whatever that thing is, that inventory management, I suppose you could call it. And apparently, as far as if you use a PC, then you would just absolutely, as a normal course of events, you would use the mod to change that thing. Again, I don't see it. I don't see why it's necessary to change it at all. But everyone else does, so have at it. I suspect it's because I've never played another game such as Skyrim. I suspect that's the reason. I think it's a very simple reason. I don't think it's complicated. It's a lack of experience on my part. I think it's very simple. Whoa, look at that big old honking. Why are you alone? Well, you're painted up, so you either belong to a giant or you're getting ready to be given to a giant. But I don't think you're supposed to be alone, either way. Okay. So at any rate, I'm having fun, and this is my lame attempt to try to get. I hear a giant. Oh, there he is. There's a giant. Okay. My lame attempt to get older people involved, and it's just a matter of of advertisement saying Skyrim for seniors, and this is an old guy who's actually doing it and actually making somewhat of a fool of himself by actually putting the stuff up on YouTube and talking out loud, the same as these young people, showing that you can be old fools as well as young fools, because certainly these young people certainly make fools out of themselves on YouTube. And I'm showing that an old guy can do it just as well as a young guy. Me making a fool of myself is in a quite a different fashion. At least I'm not doing it profanely and foolishly. I'm just doing it lamely. And slowly. And unfunnily. That's not a word. Oh, well, you know what I mean. And boringly. Ah, there we go. Boringly. There's the word I was searching for. Yes, yes. I spent my entire life trying to improve my vocabulary, and now that I need it, my memory is such that I can't dredge up the proper word at the proper time. It's absolutely infuriating. And there's a third reason I'm doing it. And that's a sort of a dedication to a group of guys that I served with long ago, almost 50 years ago, not quite, 45 years ago, back in my Marine Corps days. And I'm just going to use some names now because I don't have time to tell the stories. But eventually I want to tell the stories. I'm just going to, as I said, give some names. There's Wirtz. I knew him at Marine Corps Air Station, Beaufort, South Carolina. Then there's Caldenburg. I don't remember where I knew Caldenburg. These guys are all senior to me. And there was Dick Diamond. Now, Dick Diamond is, I knew him a couple different places. I knew him in country. Whenever I say in country, I mean Vietnam. And then at El Toro, Marine Corps Air Station El Toro. That's in California. That's no longer a Marine Corps Air Station. El Toro was in Orange County in a place called Irvine Ranch. Even then, in the 69, late 69, and the 70s, early 70s, it was beginning to be encroached upon by the growth in Orange County.
I must deal with petty thievery and drunken brawls. Been too long since we've had a good bandit.
It obviously, the growth grew up around it, and what happens with airports is the civilians buy houses around them, then they complain about the noise. And then eventually, in the case of a military airport, they're forced to move, which they did. It's off in the desert somewhere now. It's not El Toro anymore. It's, I knew where it is, but I've forgotten. But El Toro is no longer a Marine Corps Air Station. It was shut down by the force of progress. Then there's Tokars. Knew him overseas. Knew him in country. Brackett, they was Quang Tree. Jerry Kunkel from Ohio, bravest man I ever met. He was crash crew in country. Top Warrior. Now, I knew him on, I was, at one point, before this happened, I was a rising star in the Marine Corps, and so they sent me to recruiter school. They were going to make a recruiter. Well, they did make a recruiter of me. They sent me to Lancaster County, Pennsylvania, land of the Mennonites and the River Brethren and the Amish, all legitimate conscientious objectors. All of whom are never going to go into the Marine Corps, but all of whom count in Washington as potential recruits. Which meant that when they assign recruiting quotas between the Army, the Navy, the Air Force and the Marines. Whoa! Wow, somebody popped up in the air. Oh, I know what's going on. Right, there's a bunch of bandits down here. And the Thalmore just ran into the bandits. And the Thalmore guy is trying to escape. Oh. Looks like they've corralled him again, and now he's back in custody. Okay. All right. And I guess all the bandits are dead. That was who popped up in the air, was he got hit by a magic spell. I got popped up in the air. At any rate, I wound up on recruiting duty in Lancaster County, and because of the predominance of the conscientious objectors in Lancaster County, it was literally impossible for all of us, Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marines, for all of us recruiters to make quota all at one time in a month. 3 out of 4 of us could generally make quota in a given month, but not all 4. Yeah, here's the bandits. You guys ran into a buzzsaw, didn't you? You should have kept your head down.
Move along.
Now, you guys do not want to tangle with me. I am no bandit. Ah, here's another bandit. I am not a bandit, and I will clean your clock. And I wasn't a good recruiter anyway. I was a terrible recruiter, actually. In fact, eventually I found myself standing at attention in front of the major's desk, and he said, Staff Sergeant Quick, you are hereby relieved of duty. You can report back to the Marine Corps for orders. So I was officially relieved of duty and sent back to the Marine Corps. I lasted 18 months of a 3-month tour of duty on recruiting duty. And it really wasn't the fault. I mean, Lancaster County was one of the worst, one of the most difficult counties to recruit in the entire country. That's true, but I cannot blame it on that. I was not a good recruiter. I had too much sympathy. You know, a guy would come in and he'd sit down across my desk and I would look at him. And by this time, let's see, this was in 71, I believe. So by this time, I'd been in the Marine Corps 5 years. I'd already been in Vietnam for a fair spell long enough. I'd seen more than my share. And I'd look at these kids sitting on the, across the desk, and I'd think, you have no business being in the Marine Corps. They will just chew you up and spit out nothing but little bitty pieces if you manage to get home alive. And I'd steer them down the hall to the Navy or the Air Force or someplace. And I was a terrible recruiter. I was just terrible. And but Top Moyer, he was my superior. Up there in Pennsylvania. And he was recon Marine. And there was a couple of Navy guys. There was Pete. Now, Pete I met after I got out. Actually, he was Navy, but I didn't know him while I was in. I met him after I got out. Then there was Shorty. Shorty was, I met him in country. He was a corpsman. Marine Corps doesn't have any medical personnel. The medical personnel for the Marine Corps are Navy. They're Navy corpsmen. And Shorty died at Contiend. I've never been to Washington. I've been to Washington. What I meant to say is that I've never been to the Marine Corps Memorial in Washington, and I'd like to go, but now I've got a bit of a problem. I don't want to drive. I'd like to go up. I don't know Shorty's name. I know when he died. I'd like to go up and see if I can find him on the wall. I don't know exactly how to get there. At any rate, there's Rick. Rick also, we were in the Marine Corps at the same time. But I never knew him until I got out. I met him after I got out. Then it was Brackett. Brackett, I'll tell you the Brackett story sometime. He at least saved me from a Purple Heart once. Probably saved my life, but at least saved me from getting a Purple Heart. And probably getting sent home because of it. Because once you get 3 Purple Hearts, they sent you home back there. I don't know how it is now. But in Vietnam, once you got 3 Purple Hearts, they sent you home. Sergeant Jones, Robert, he was crash crew. I met him. Oh, I know. He met him at El Toro in base housing. I was married, and by the time I met him, we just had a daughter. We only had the daughter then, because Patrick was born in on recruiting duty up in Lancaster. Come back here. They lived across the way in base housing, Robert and his wife and their 2 daughters. That's where I met. He was crash crew also, same as Jerry Kunkel. Jerry Kunkel was crash crew. And Pete Shorey. Then there was John Seymour and Larry Molenkoff. They worked for me in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. I was the senior man at the office there in Lancaster. And John and Larry worked for me. They were good Marines. They're better recruiters than I was. Obviously, they didn't get relieved of duty. I was the one that got relieved of duty. Then it was Royce Gibbs. I knew him at El Toro. He got orders the same time I did. Same time I got orders to go on recruiting duty, he got orders to go to the drill field to be a drill instructor. That's not Jones. That's all right. I'm reading notes here, and that's not Jones. That's Sergeant Janes. That's right, Sergeant Janes. Yeah, I remember Sergeant Janes' wife died. His wife had cancer, and she died. But all of these guys, every one of these guys, there's a story. And I have a friend named John. He lives here in the upstate with me. And John is a very good friend. I've known John now for about, 20 years now. I don't think I'm being too dramatic to say that after Sherry died, John probably went a long way to help me stay in this world. John is a true friend, not like one of these friends nowadays. Of course, I'm not on Facebook. I'm not on any, what do they call them? Social media. I'm not on any social media network of any kind. Wait a minute. John is a true friend in the old-fashioned sense of the word, the kind that it takes you 5 or 6 years to realize is a friend and is a real friend. John's heard about all these guys from the Marine Corps days, and I think John thinks that they're imaginary. Because, people like this couldn't exist, because I haven't told any of the stories yet, so you'll begin to think they're imaginary once I begin to tell you about them, but they're not. Every one of these guys are real. Now, I think all but one or two of them, a couple of them are my age, so they wouldn't be in their 70s, they'd be in their late 60s. Every one of them would be in their 70s, and several of them would be in their early 80s by now. But they're all old guys by now. Like I said, 70s or 80s. But they're all real, John. They're not made up. They're all real guys. John's the only local guy. And John's an import. John's actually from UK, from England, jolly old England. But he's a local guy now. He's getting his, might already have his citizenship. I'm not sure. He's gone through all the paperwork and stuff. I don't keep up with all that stuff all that carefully. I did for a while, John is, very important to me. If you get a friend, a real friend, if you get one in your lifetime, you're doing very well. All you folks that think you have 50 or 100 friends, you're kidding yourself. If you have one real friend, count yourself very fortunate in life. And I'm dedicating this effort to these guys, these Marines that I served with. These are some of the most extraordinary men that I've ever known. These are men that helped shape who I became as an adult. I learned a great deal from them during the years that I served with them. Each and every one of them is extraordinary in their own way. I won't talk about them a lot, but over the course of this thing, I will bring up their stories and tell you about them. And this whole effort is dedicated to them. Again, I owe my life to them in different ways. And I appreciate them tremendously. They're a huge part of who I am and why I've become who I am and why I've managed to survive. And speaking of surviving, we have and that's it for now. And that's it. So, we've got fun. We've got old folks. And a dead dragon who will fly away somewhere to die. So, looks like he just went right up there. Okay. All right. Well, since he seems like he just went right up. Right up there, might as well just run up there and see if we can oh, yeah, there's his fur that he's cut. Oh, come on, come on. Jump, jump, jump. Wow. Not want to get up there. Whew. Good grief. No, go away. And there's my Dwarven arrow in him. Yep. Okay. All right. Well, that's good enough. Okay. We'll call it quits there. So there you have it. Fun. Old folks and old Marine Corps buddies. That's what I'm doing it for. And that's it, folks.